Ah, cool. An interesting one, and I assume it's going to be a quick section, number four. Talking about different types of risks. So I would say that this is not an exhaustive list. Depending on organizations, depending on industries, depending on people, we can come up with as many types as we deem appropriate. But here, their idea is just to familiarize us with a few popularly considered categories there, or sorry, rather types. Or yeah, section four, three more to go. So halfway through, halfway more. I assume when I say halfway more, yeah, close to 60 odd slides, I guess, is what we have.
Okay.
Yeah, 65 is what we reached at. Not even 60. So yeah, the second half should be relatively quicker as compared to the first one. All
Okay.
right, section number four, risk types. Where they're going to take us through the four main types of business risks: financial ones, compliance, operational, strategic. Financial, quite self-explanatory, anything which has to do with budgets and money. So any uncertainties across negative impact or loss due to or maybe losing out money or maybe gaining money is what we call as financial risk. Compliance risk is the risks or the uncertainties across areas where we are supposed to satisfy regulatory norms or policies or even, let's say, statutory requirements. So inability to meet them is basically more or less, or likelihood of inability of meeting them is what we call as a compliance risk. Operational risks, not being able to achieve or let's say not being able to deliver day-to-day value to our customers is like the biggest operational risk that we can think of. And strategic risk, not being able to innovate, not being able to achieve a visualized of missions, or not being able to realize strategies the way we intend to is like the biggest idea or example of strategic risk. So let's try to elaborate each of them with their definitions and a few more examples. Starting things out with strategic risk. Strategic risks are those that can affect an organization's ability to achieve its overall objectives. Some examples include risks to market presence, share, or position. The biggest of them all, reputation risks. Further, the risk that a business plan to which a large number of resources and time have been committed can ultimately fail due to lack of acceptance in the marketplace. If I may give you an example, I don't have the browser open there. Oh, there you go. Do you remember this phone, maybe? iPhone SE 1. iPhone SE 1. Any chance of you having seen this phone?
Possibly. At
Possibly, yeah.
that
For I mean,
time,
it's quite an old phone.
I was not really a fan of iPhone.
So now you are, right?
Yeah.
Perfect, perfect. There you go. So this design is pretty much on. I won't say not pretty much. It's identical to iPhone 5, which was a very popular iPhone back in the days.
Yes.
Now, the problem which happened with Apple was that they had released this version of iPhone and calling it iPhone SE after they had released iPhone 6. And if you recall iPhone 6, or rather 6S, alongside 6S, as it mentioned here, 6S had a longer design, had a bigger screen, had an advanced processor and everything. This thing had the same processor, had the same RAM, but was enclosed in a smaller size, which automatically means that this should be priced comparatively lesser as compared to 6S. But the price variation was not much, which meant that I will not like to pay $100 for a 4.7-inch screen when I can get a 5.1-inch screen for by paying $10 more or maybe $20 or even $50 more. Now, as a result of this, the whole strategy backfired, and they had the amount of resources and time that they had committed across this whole thing was more of a failure. Right? So that's a typical example of strategy that you can think of. But I could say the same for, if you remember, there was this phone called as Samsung Galaxy Note 7, which if you travel, they all even announced that if you're carrying an iPhone, a Note 7, please take it out of your bag, please dispose it off. Because of certain failures, which resulted the whole strategy into a big failure. And then Samsung was like supposed to recall all those products.
Yes.
That was a strategic risk. The second one that we have here is financial risk. Financial risks are those risks that affect an organization's ability to meet its financial obligations. Three main sources of this risk include the organization's exposure to changes in market prices, as in how much will the organization be impacted if the cost of products and resources that they purchase changes, actions and transactions with other organizations, and internal actions and organizational failures. So, I mean, a very subjective way of looking at financial risks. Therefore, I said anything which has something to do with money, something monetary, and if there's some form of uncertainty around it, safe to assume it will be categorized under financial risks.
Okay. Going through it. No issue.
Yeah, there you go. So that's where they like broken it down furthermore. We can have exchange rate risks. Now, this comes into picture when, as an organization, I engage with foreign trades. So we are here in India, we have the currency called as the Indian rupees. And if we are dealing with customers who are paying to us in dollars, the exchange rate and stuff is something that we need to consider as in when we are making the setting up the prices. Because if we don't do so, we will constantly be subjected to losing money out of it. Mm-hmm. Market risks, as in what if the market changes the prices of stuff or the products or resources that we as consumers consume are subjected to ups and downs. I mean, ups as in loss, downs as in an opportunity. Interest rate risks, if we have taken up loans and stuff with the bank. Mm-hmm. Investments or stocks and stuff, liquidity risks, the ability of quickly converting assets into liquid cash. So inability to do so will be liquidity risk and inflation risks. Again, they just don't want us to like get into the absolute details because the list is again not exhaustive. There can be many other financial risks and other categories to it as well. Then a quite relevant one, compliance risks. Organizations that fail to act in accordance with laws, regulations, and internal policies face compliance risk. Compliance risk refers to the organization's exposure to material loss. And by material loss, they mean financial loss. And legal penalties as a result of non-compliance with applicable laws, regulatory requirements, and other compliance obligations. For instance, commitments with contracts. A few other examples include environmental risks, because if there are laws and regulations which exist with respect to environmental safety, environmental protection, not following them appropriately leads to compliance risks. Occupational health and safety risks, one of the reasons why all our office rooms and chambers have smoke detectors and fire water sprinklers because of occupational health and safety risks. In fact, occupational health and safety is way more than what we think of it as physical safety and stuff. It's also about mental health these days.
Okay.
Corrupt practices, social responsibilities, ensuring the right level of quality, because what if that has been agreed with the customers and we don't deliver to them? That would basically be breaching a contractual commitment. all of these would qualify for as compliance risks. There you go, kind of stressing more on the occupational health and safety. Occupational health risk deals with health and safety in workplace. Its main focus is the prevention of hazards. The health of workers is of paramount importance because workers are the most important asset of an organization. Mm-hmm. There are several risk factors that can be encountered in the workplace, which include accidents, musculoskeletal disorders, respiratory diseases, accidents, which is why we try to make sure that the floors are kept dry. If not, people are being alerted out of it. The rooms are like constructed in such a way that the doors don't collide unnecessarily. Musculoskeletal disorders, which is why we make sure that the chairs and tables that we have are of a good build and a good quality there. Respiratory diseases, oftentimes we see that smoking zones are placed outside or at least a bit farther away so that people having respiratory issues don't have those challenges. They're not subjected to hearing impairment, which is why the office places are relatively quiet. Circulatory diseases having things to do with blood circulation is what I assume that was what they mean out of it. Stress-related disorders, which is like the most common one to come across. Communicable diseases, which is why many times they recommend, ever since the corona thing happened, they recommend wearing masks, maintaining distances at offices as well, cancers and anything other. So anything which can put the life of employees in danger is potentially an occupational health and safety hazard and has to be well taken care of. A few other work-related risks could be something to do with physical, as in warm or cold objects, airborne particles, equipment, machinery, electricity. Again, you notice each of these words kind of makes us imagine different industries, like yes. Warm and cold objects. For example, things to do with refrigeration or cooking.
Yeah.
Airborne particles, let's say if you're working in a mine or somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
Equipment and machinery, production units. Electricity, falling objects, construction, sharp objects, knives and stuff. So that's the physical side. Chemical, as in any hazardous and dangerous substances from, again, factories, combustible material, fire, exposure, etc. On the biological side, as soon as I read that word biological, I immediately started imagining hospitals and stuff. So pathogens, yes. Microorganisms, animals, birds, zoo, insects, toxins, etc. Psychosocial, workload, stress, health, personal issues, etc., which is where we have now started discussing topics such as emotional intelligence and stuff. And on the physiological side, physical stress, hypothermia, blood pressure, diabetes, all of these are also being considered. Operational risks, the fourth type, I reckon. Yep, the fourth kind. Operational risks refer to losses resulting from inadequate procedures, policies, and systems within an organization. The word operation suggests things which an organization does on a day-to-day basis. Things which an organization does in order to run its business. That's operations. So inability of performing efficiently, effectively would result into losses. And the likelihood of this is what we consider to be as a part of operational risk. Operational risks occur due to organization's failure in core processes. Therefore, it can be considered as the risk of not achieving intended outcomes. An effective and ongoing risk management process within an organization is essential. Since it provides treatment options for operational risks and supports the organization in working towards the prevention and mitigation of new risks because of the iterative ongoing nature which risk management has, just like operations. Yeah. So, Ms. Renee, any questions with respect to the four different kinds? I think they were quite generic here, right?
Yes, I think it's generic. But I believe that it is due to the content. But I see that. But ESG, I wanted to talk about quickly ESG, environmental, social, and governance. And I believe that it's part of the type of risk that you have just presented. So there is risk. Environmental also sits under compliance and social as well. So it's fine for me. It's fine for me. My question was on finance, but you've mentioned already more details because the slide before that.
Okay.
So the point two and point three was not clear to me from that description, but when going through the different financial risk that we've just discussed, I was more clear about what needed to be considered at that level. So it's fine.
Perfect. Thank you. So in the next few slides, 1, 2, and 3, I think there's the two of them. They're wanting us to look at the changing landscapes across with respect to risk, both in terms of likelihoods of occurrence and the kind of impact that they could have. Top five global risks in terms of,
if you allow me, I was having the question about technology mm-hmm. risk, but I believe it's sitting under operational, right?
Yep, exactly. I won't say operational alone. It could even be strategic. If emerging technology and inability to take advantage out of them can result into losses.
Okay.
So, yeah. I mean, you actually made a very good point. What about technological risks? What about some others? I mean, if you notice on the diagram here, economic, we can consider it something to be the part of financial. Environmental, we saw. Societal can be again considered to be a part of the last section that we saw, maybe something to do with compliance, environmental safety, health and safety. But they have given us a few more: geopolitical, technological. Right. So the safest way to remember how can I classify risk is that you can think, make use of this very simple technique called as the PESL analysis. Probably might have even heard of it. So
yes.
Stands for political, economical, social, technological, legal, and environmental. Yep. Out of the six of these, back in the days, people only used to make references to the first four, PEST, as it was known as the PEST analysis. But later on, they realized legal and environmental are also other subtypes that we can consider. So might as well call it as the PESL analysis.
Okay.
Now, they've defined the top five global risks in terms of likelihood year after year from 2014 to 2015. So back in 2014, income disparity, extreme weather events. I think extreme weather remained a top concern with respect to likelihood every year. And year after year, we keep on seeing extreme weather conditions becoming a far more likelihood with respect to risks. Unemployment, climate change, cyber attacks started to find its way, which has ever since grown, I would say. So yeah, if you notice back in 2018, this is just cyber attacks have found themselves the third spot. Data fraud and theft again finding its place onto the list. Failure of climate change mitigation and adaptation. Extreme weather condition tops the list as of now in 2018. Now this is with respect to likelihood of occurrences of certain unwanted events. With respect to impacts, the list says, fiscal crises, which hit back in 2014, climate change, water crisis, unemployment and underemployment, critical infrastructure were the concerns and biggest impact causing risks back in 2014, which today have risen to weapons of mass destruction. Extreme weather condition finds its sweet spot at number second. Due to extreme weather conditions, it's safe to assume natural disasters can also find places. Failure of climate change mitigation and adaptation, water crisis remains a constant impact. So these are just a few, I would say, categories of risks which have been depicted across to find the top five places all across the globe. With respect to likelihood, as in the chances of their occurrence, and impact, as in the consequence that they will have. Risk types. Different types of risk occur due to failures of an organization's core processes to achieve the intended outcomes. I assume that's what we call as operational risk. List at least three types of risks that can be present in an organization and support your answer with examples. So we've discussed strategic, we discussed financial, we discussed compliance, we discussed operational. You've already pointed out technological. So any two other types that you can think of?
I can also, we said compliance, but we have not said, we have not talked about political risk. But we are talking about operational failure in the organization. Yes. I think not being able to, it's something that we can say yes or no, political risk, because there are, in terms of business continuity and resilience, activities that we have to perform in order to ensure that the political risk is assessed properly and is properly monitored. In our region, I'll be honest to say that in Benin, the political, let's say, the political environment in Benin has been stable for more than a decade, but since 2019, we have started to see some political unrest. Yes. So I will give you the what happened actually. So I was just within the position, and We were planning to organize the everything around the elections. The team that is that actually have in my team, I don't have new staff. The people that are in my team now were in the former team, so they had their way of doing things and maybe a kind of complacency. So when I came by and I said to them, okay, we are going through presidential election in a few months. Mm-hmm. So tell me, what is your risk assessment? Show me the risk assessment that you have done. And they said to me, Rene, we don't foresee anything to happen. Benin has always been quite okay. So if something happened, it will be very small. We will not feel it. And in terms of providing like guidance on what we should do, they did the minimum. Actually, they did the minimum. But what happened on the field is that then we end up being into a crisis. And I was just in the position without a lot of without a lot of information, and I was like trying to deal with my peers and with the CEO on the way we really badly manage the election. So that's why I think I can put it there. So from an operational point of view, not being able to assess the strength or the vulnerabilities of our business continuity operating model on the managing elections, presidential elections, because we leverage our judgment only mm-hmm. focused on the past, that the past was quite stable and we have not foreseen that something could happen.
So, true.
So that's one point. The other point that I might say is the compliance risk, and a compliance risk resulting to a fine. So, so basically, the marketing communication are regulated. They are regulated. And there is an assumption that the head of commercial will be completely aware of what they can do or on what they cannot do if they have to communicate on offers and promotions. So they went on the market with an offer and they communicate on that, but the communication was really not compliant at all to the regular, to the law. So it resulted into a fine. And that fine came just 2 weeks. I entered the position, just 2 weeks. Entered the position and I had to face that fine. And I think that the issue here is that we didn't have a process to validate communications before it goes to the market. While we, I would say that first there was ignorance because our management was not aware of the laws, but also a weakness in the compliance process because we should have been able to communicate what are what is the regulatory universe, what is the compliance universe, and to make sure that the people outside, they know that there is a specific law that they have to comply with. So I think that's the second example I can share to you. And the rest of the element that I can share with you is much more from an internal control point of view. And I think having, let's say, processes that are manual, that are not documented, and having also managers not willing to perform the control activity or not being aware of the fact that they have a responsibility in terms of ensuring that their activities are properly controlled. So. That's
why
I can share.
Cool. That gets us done with the second exercise here and finishes off with the fourth section as well.